this session, if it had a title, it would be titled hashtag backwards. In fact, it's entitled hashtag backwards. The reason being, there's a mistake that most people make, and they apply this mistake to their careers, to their businesses, to their marketing campaigns, and also to their recruitment campaigns and project plans. And that problem, that mistake that people make is really simple. We plan forwards. Now, the challenge with planning forwards, obviously, it's logical, it's rational, it seems to make sense. Well, this is what I'm doing now, so the next stages, and then the next stages, and then the next stages. But the problem is that where you are now has constraints, it has limitations, it has preconceptions. But where you're going to be in 6 months, 3 years, 5 years is very different, and all of the preconceptions and all of the assumptions can change in that period of time. So assuming going forwards is going to be pretty much the same as today is inherently either massively limiting or outrageously optimistic, and neither of those is great when it comes to planning an activity. So I'm going to stick with two examples. Actually, no, I'll go with three examples. First example is planning a recruitment campaign. You have an assignment, you've got a result you intend to achieve. The second being business planning, let's say 3 years of business planning. And the third being your life, 10 years of your life. There's no magic about 10 years, it's just a random number that I popped into my head. So I'm going to go for 10 years. Now, if you approach a recruitment assignment and say, okay, where am I now? How do I do this job? And Aisha is just joining us. Okay, so if you are working on an assignment and the way you work it is to say, okay, what comes next? What's the next step and the next step and the next step? What you will do inevitably is just replicate what you've already done. Maybe with a couple of tweaks and adjustments, maybe with a couple of slightly changed assumptions about what's possible and what isn't. Maybe you change the conversion factors, or you change the speed a little bit. But what would happen if you went hashtag backwards when it comes to planning? What if you totally changed the rules? And if you said, okay, I have this assignment. When would I want this assignment to be finished, to be closed? Okay, 4 months. Fine. If I'm going to have this done in 4 months, in 3.5 months from now, what has to have happened? What needs to be in place for my 4 month goal to be absolutely inevitable? Not possible, not conceivable, not likely, but inevitable. Because once you start thinking about what has to happen to make something inevitable, it's very different from planning from here forwards, because from here forwards is based on what's likely, what's probable, what's happened before. So that simple paradigm, that simple, for want of a better term, paradigm shift of change all the assumptions happens instantly when you go from the end backwards. It's a massive shift. So if I want to have this placement done in 4 months, what has to happen by month 3.5 for that to be inevitable? Well, by month 3.5, whoever the candidate is has to have been offered and has to have put in forward their notice, unless they're on a week's notice, which, okay. But you're going to have them offered, accepted, and resigned, and any potential counteroffer dealt with. Okay, in order for that to be in place in 3.5 months' time, what has to have happened by month 3, by month 2, by month 1? And when you work back, instead of working forwards, it gives you a set of deliverables. It gives you a set of results that have to be in place. If it's a longer project, you might call them milestones. They are absolute fixed points of achievement. So if your type of candidate, for example, is on a month's notice, just for the sake of a number, by the start of month by the end of month three, they have to have offer acceptance, resigned, dealt with counter offer. That has to be done by the end of month two. It has to be there, at the end of month three. Sorry, somebody's got their speaker on. They're talking to their dog, I think. If we could just mute off for a second, that would be lovely. So in order to have offer acceptance and counter offer dealt with so that we can start at the end of month four, at the end of month three, all of that has to have been done. Okay, so in order for that to be inevitable, in order for offer acceptance and dealing with the counter offer to have been done by the end of month three, what has to have happened by the end of month two? Well, we've probably had to go through the interview process. We've probably had to start scoping out the offer. We may not have firmed it up yet. We may not have negotiated the final package, but we've probably gone through a bit of the process and started lining that up. In order for that to be in place, what has to have happened by the end of month one? Interview process underway, certainly first, maybe second out of the way, maybe we're down to final interview. We're lining out the process, but we're setting it up with milestones of absolute fixed points of achievement. If you did the same with your business on a 3-year timescale, okay, ideal world, forget all your preconceptions, forget all your existing knowledge about what you think is possible, because most of the great achievements that you see weren't possible until somebody did it. I've got some friends, colleagues, clients who've built a £35 million recruitment business based purely on other people's talents. They're perfectly competent recruiters, but they're by no means superstars. However, they are awesome at bringing talent in, financing them, systemizing them, encouraging them, and letting them go out and grow the business. So they haven't grown from their own organic base. They've grown from a different set of assumptions. They've decided that, you know, recruitment, yeah, okay, cash flow, which is what most people use it for, yeah, that's fine, but what could we do if we did something different? So there's lots of ways of skinning the same onion. So if you didn't know what was possible, what would you like your business, if you don't own a business, what would you like your desk, your personal desk, to look like 3 years from now? What kind of clients do you want? What kind of revenue are you doing? What level of activity are you doing? Do you have colleagues around you? Just close your eyes for a second and imagine it. See what you see, hear what you hear, feel what you feel. If it works for you, smell what you smell. But just make it as real as possible. Where are you 3 years from now? Who are you with? What's happening? What does it look like? What does it sound like? What does it feel like? And then open your eyes up, and that is your 3-year objective. Great. Now let's plan it using that hashtag backwards technique. In order for that 3-year outcome to be absolutely inevitable, not possible, not feasible, not realistic, this has got nothing to do with realism. We can do that check later. But in order for that to be absolutely inevitable, what has to have happened? What has to be in place 2.5 years from now? What are those deliverables, those outcomes that must be in place 2.5 years from now for our 3-year plan to be absolutely inevitable, certain, locked in. Now work back to 2 years. What has to be in place? What has to have happened? Where do you have to be 2 years from now to make, not the end goal, but to make the 2.5 year deliverables inevitable? So each time you come back, and I'm randomly picking the time scale of 6 months, so you go 3 years, 2.5 years, where do I have to be for 3 years to be inevitable? 2 years, where do I have to be for 2.5 years to be inevitable and locked in? 18 months, where do I have to be for 2 years to be certain, inevitable, locked in, going to happen? Work back to a year, work back to 6 months, work back to tomorrow morning. And you're not planning from here to there. Because, you know, sometimes if your goal is big enough, if you've set yourself what's called a BHAG, a big hairy ass goal, if you've set yourself a BHAG and you think about where you are now, the bridge from there to there, or the leap from there to there, might be just massive. It's inconceivable potentially. But that's okay, because it's inconceivable for me to go from here to the Colosseum on foot. That's inconceivable. I can't do it. But if I take a step and a step and another step and another step, maybe I'm at Dover 3 months from now. Maybe I'm at Paris 3 months after that. Maybe I'm down on the Côte d'Azur 6 months after that. Step by step by step. The mistake people make is trying to leap from today to 3 years or whatever timescale you set. And that's either just a slightly different version of today, which is a waste of everybody's time, effort and emotional input. Or it's, yeah, that'd be amazing, but I don't believe a damn word of it. What this hashtag backwards process does, and I've been using it for years, and then a couple of years ago, I saw it put out there into the world by a guy called James Wedmore. And he introduced it to hundreds of thousands of people. But to be fair, and some of my colleagues will back this up, some of the people on this webinar will back me up, I was there 20 years ago. The concept of hashtag backwards, start with the end in mind, as James Covey wrote in the Stephen Covey wrote in The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. The end in this case being your goal. Where do you want your business, your desk, your personal business, your enterprise to be 3 years from now, and then set the milestones that have to be achieved for that outcome to be inevitable. Not possible, but inevitable. And work towards those. And obviously the last step of your planning process is what happens tomorrow or next week. But just work back. There's no magical timescales. Just work back to what works. The closer I come in time, typically the shorter the timescale I work with. So the first 12 months I tend to work in 9 month, 6 month, 3 month, and then I get down to weeks. Because this bit, the next 12 weeks, tomorrow and tomorrow, to misquote Shakespeare, those are what make 6 months inevitable. And 6 months is what makes 12 months inevitable. So what I do next week needs to be there in as much detail as possible so that I can push forwards and start making my 3 months, 6, 9, 12 months inevitable. Okay? It's in the same way as when a lot of people are onboarding staff or colleagues, they'll go through a 30-60-90 plan. Well, 30-60-90 going forwards from today is normally just a slightly different flavour of today. It's much better to go 90-60-30 and work backwards from the end to today. I also talked about the life plan. It's exactly the same process. If you have, or if you want to have a 10-year life plan, excuse me for one second. If you have, or you want to have a 10-year life plan, the critical aspect is envisioning that 10 years and then literally working back to what has to be in place for it to be absolutely locked in, certain, inevitable. So if 10 years from now, you want to be retired, living on your investment income, traveling the world, spending the entire winter skiing, hell, I know, spending the entire summer skiing because you go off to Chile, whatever. Whatever your particular life plan is, or if you just want to have a nice, comfortable life and the kids around you and dog and three cats and whatever works for you, however grandiose and world-changing your life plan is, or how conservative and comfortable and based around safety your life plan is, that's up to you. It's your life. It doesn't matter to me. I'm not one of those people that demands that you have this grandiose, massive vision of private jets and yachts and all that sort of stuff, because honestly, that's not a lot of people's real outcome. It's quite often what people think they're supposed to achieve, but it's not. Speaking personally, I've gone down the empire building route, and you know, I've had the big mansion in Marbella, and I've flown private. My friend's plane, I'll admit, I've flown private. I've had the ludicrous car. In my case, it was an AMG Mercedes. It was this ludicrous estate car, station wagon, that had gone through the AMG workshop. It was ridiculous. It was the size of a small house, and it did 0-60 in 4.5 seconds. And you know, I've done all that stuff. I've had the watches, I've had the cars, I've had the houses, and none of it made me happy. So I don't want that anymore. That's not what I'm looking for. What I'm looking for is the ability to go places, do things, meet people. That doesn't mean that when I'm in those places, I won't be in a nice house, but my focus is on the experiences and the places rather than the stuff. I live in Britain. There's very little point in current day England in having a nice watch if you're ever going to go to London, because it just paints a target on you for people to mug you and take your watch. So I've kind of, okay, the watch is quite nice because, you know, it's something that I can leave to people. It's something that's always there. You know, if I ever get into financial problems, I could probably pawn it off, you know, take a loan against it, whatever. But most of the stuff is just an unnecessary expense. Not interested. So think about your 10 years. What is it that you want? Where do you want to be? What life do you want? Who's around you? What kind of home do you have? Where are you? What does it feel like? How warm is it? How cold is it? Is it in the countryside? Is it in the town? Is it in the city? Is it a flat on the Thames or on a lake? Or are you overlooking the sea? Are you in the countryside? You'll have gathered from the heavy mowing noises that were there at the start of this particular session that I'm in the countryside. But where are you 10 years from now? Who's with you? What do you hear? What do you see? What does it feel like? Okay, now come back to 9 years. 9 years from now, what has to be in place? What has to be there for your 10-year life goal to be inevitable, not possible, not feasible, certainly not realistic, the hell with realism. What has to be in place 9 years from now for your 10 years to be absolutely certain and locked in? For example, if you're going to 10 years from now live off your passive investment income, by 9 years from now, you better have a good chunk of passive investment in place. So it's amazing how many people plan to live off their passive investment income, you know, live off property or their index tracker fund or whatever, but it never occurs to them that they have to actually get that in place. So what has to be in place 9 years from now for it to be inevitable, locked in place, absolutely going to happen? Come back to 8 years, you've got the routine by now. Take out a pen and a piece of paper. It's, I don't know about you, but I find this fun. My partner and I were doing this a couple of weeks ago. We did an 8-year life and business plan because obviously my life and business are quite closely the same. So we did this 8-year plan. 8 years because in 8 years' time, I reach a sort of big birth date, let's put it that way. So that was kind of a line in the sand. The calendar isn't a rule of what you can and can't do, but it was just a decent line in the sand. So 8 years. And we had a ball with this. It took us a few sessions, and it took us nearly a weekend and a bit. It took us a long weekend to actually do this. Huge amount of fun, because you're imagining the fun stuff that you're going to have and be and do. Because those are three questions. What do you want to have, be, and do 10 years from now? For that to happen, what do you have to have, be, and do 9 years from now for that to be inevitable? 8 years from now, what do you have to have, be, and do in place for 9 years to happen? And you work it back until you get to tomorrow morning or next week. And that is your trigger. Because once you've come backwards, you can start making daily, weekly, monthly progress towards something exciting and tangible and motivational, something inspiring, without all the limitations of all the history that you're carrying. Just take your history off, put it in a big bag, leave it over there, and start moving forwards to what you want to achieve, to the placements you want to achieve, to the business or desk you want to build, to the life you want to create. And do it hashtag backwards, because that way you leave all the baggage over there. Because the great thing about the past is, it's past. You can't relive the past. Don't know about you, but I've tried. You can't relive the past. So why do we all assume that the past must equal the future? It can't. It doesn't. If you can't relive it, the past cannot equal the future. Just because it happened in the past doesn't mean it has to happen in the future. So work backwards from the end you want and set those milestones. Whatever time scale you do, whether it's a 4-month recruitment project or a 10-year life plan, 30-year life plan, 50 years, whatever, your life, your rules, your planning. But whatever your time scale is, go at it backwards. Approach your life and approach your business and approach your assignments backwards. Yeah, I know how that sounds, but I also know it works. In fact, in my experience, it's the only planning that genuinely works consistently if you want to make things change. Let me give you one big example. It's too grandiose for most of us to get our heads around, but it's a fabulous example. Okay. Elon Musk didn't start with, I'd like to build a rocket. Elon Musk started with, I want to be part of a colony of humans living on Mars. Okay, what has to happen for a colony to be living on Mars? Well, we have to be able to support ourselves. We have to work out how we're going to feed ourselves, how we're going to generate oxygen and air. Oh, and we need to work out how we're going to get there. And you come back and back and back and back and back. And you start with, I need to work out how to build a rocket. I don't have the money to build a rocket. So what has to be in place? What has to happen in order for me to build a rocket? I have to get NASA to pay for it. How do I get NASA to pay for it? I convince NASA that if I build this rocket, I can take all their satellites and their payloads up more cheaply than they can. How do I convince NASA? And now we're off to the races. Now we can move forwards to put a colony on Mars. But if you start with, oh, I'd like to build a rocket. How on earth do you go from, I want to build a rocket to, I want to have a colony on Mars? In fact, he probably didn't want to build a rocket. There just isn't an alternative. There's no other way of leaving Earth's gravity well than a rocket. I imagine he's probably looked at all the potential alternatives and settled on a rocket as the only way of doing it. But that's one example. Or Steve Jobs. I'm recording this second recording of this is on an iPhone. Steve Jobs did not sit down and go, oh, it'd be nice to make a slightly better phone, slightly better mobile phone. Because when the iPhone came out, Android didn't exist. People were working on BlackBerries or Windows phones, which was as horrible as it sounds. The BlackBerry was okay. A Windows phone was truly awful experience. But he didn't say, let's build a slightly better phone. His focus was on changing the way people lived and then working back from that. Was it realistic? Not even slightly. Was it feasible? No. But that goal and working back to it made the rest of it, the operating system, the Gorilla Glass, the design of the phone, the interface, the whole thing, that didn't come forwards. It came backwards from the end goal. Everything great works backwards from the end. Start with the end in mind. And apply that to your marketing campaigns, to your business growth strategy, to your recruitment assignments, to your business plan, to your life plan, to your investments. Work back from the end and focus on what do I have to have, be and do at each stage to make the next stage absolutely inevitable. And one other question I'm going to leave you with: if I knew that I couldn't fail, if you knew that you could not fail, what would you do? And I bet it's slightly different to what you have been doing. Because with almost everybody I've ever met, that's been true. Ask yourself that question. If I couldn't fail, what would I do? What would make me happy and fulfilled if I knew with certainty that I could not fail? And then work back from that and go off and make it happen. Just a thought, it's only a suggestion, said the hypnotist. In the shirt and tie, I'm trying to remember the last time I was in a shirt and tie. I think it was about 2018. When I was going off to a meeting in the city. There's a particular reason today. If you really want to know, drop me a note and I'll tell you. But anyway, that's me done for this session.